Hello and welcome to Wilson Center Now, a production of the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars. I'm John Molesky. My guest today is Joby Warrick. Joby has been writing for the Washington Post since 1996. He's a two-time Pulitzer Prize winning reporter and author, and he's also been a Wilson Center Public Policy Fellow twice. He joins us today to discuss his latest book. It's titled Red Line: The Unraveling of Syria and America's Race to Destroy the Most Dangerous Arsenal in the World. Joby, you've done it again. Terrific book.
Thank you so much, John. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Let's start with the title. And if you could tell us about how the idea, the concept of red line emerged in this story, when did it first come into play?
So it really predates the political discussion of red lines, which becomes really what the American debate is all about. But in my career, and particularly over the last 20 years, I focused on three subjects: the Middle East, terrorism, and weapons of mass destruction. Here we have a potential of all three of these coming together at once. We have Arab Spring uprisings, you've got terrorist groups springing up in the region, and then you've got this unique problem that Syria has of a weapon of mass destruction, chemical weapons within this country that's being torn apart by a civil war. And for me, this is a fascinating subject, and not surprisingly, the people in the world that I speak to, security officials and diplomats and others, they are seized on this issue as far back as 2011, really worried about the possibility of all these elements converging in a catastrophic way.
So President Obama initially was criticized for the introduction of a red line because people thought it backed him into a corner.
It's true. So this becomes, you know, part of his legacy that I'm sure that many officials around him would like to redo. But that itself is actually an interesting story, because the language red line grows out of intelligence that the White House was receiving in 2012, which pointed to a very dire circumstance. There was real intelligence coming in about Syria taking these dangerous weapons and moving them, potentially giving them to an ally, to a next door neighbor. There's this group Hezbollah, this militia group that's next door in Lebanon. And there was intelligence that these weapons were going to be given away. And so you see the Obama administration quite alarmed in the middle of 2012, and they're starting to put out warnings. They're doing it privately through diplomatic channels, but they're also going up publicly and saying, Syria, don't do this. And in one instance, sort of the infamous statement by Obama, he's asked about this issue at a press conference, sort of the last question at a long news conference about something unrelated. And this time he uses the phrase red line. If Syria moves these weapons, if it uses them, it'll cross a red line for us. And that becomes the fateful term, because it has all these expectations. What does that mean to most people? It meant a military strike. And so that becomes this albatross in terms of policy that hangs around Obama's neck from the rest of the
world. But that's the hindsight, the 2020 vision advantage, correct? But would it be fair to say that at the time, it also was a rallying point for more international cooperation, or at least agreement that this was a line that shouldn't be crossed?
It was taken very seriously by everybody. The Russians certainly believed it. They believe that if Assad kept pushing the limits and using chemical weapons, that America would come and crack down on them. The Syrian opposition certainly took it seriously. And there was this belief that if this red line was crossed, America is going to come to our aid. We'll have America's sort of guarantee of a good outcome of this war. So that's why the phrase becomes so meaningful, because people read into it their own expectations, which made the situation much more complicated.
Mm-hmm. And so, you know, Syria provides an example on every level of what a disaster looks like: humanitarian, militarily, politically, in all ways. What happened from the moment where there seemed to be international support and resolve, and that leads to the notion of unraveling, which is part of the title of your book?
So bringing people back, because I think a lot of this history went by us. There was a lot of other things going on in the world at the time, including the rise of ISIS and many other distractions. But there was this moment in 2013 when a terrible chemical weapon attack happens outside Damascus. 1,400 people are killed, almost all of them civilians, mostly women and children, killed in their sleep by sarin, this horrible chemical weapon. And there's this moment where the entire world seems to rally and say, we got to get rid of it. We got to do something about this. Even the Russians, you know, as Assad's chief ally in the world, says, yeah, it's time. This is an embarrassment to us. It's you know, bringing the possibility of an American military strike. We need to find a diplomatic solution. And so this agreement was reached fairly quickly to avoid a war or a larger war by getting rid of the entire stockpile of chemical weapons that Syria had amassed over over more than a decade. All these terrible things that we worried about losing control of, if we could sweep them all up and get them out of the country, that's a great benefit for everyone. And it is punishment for Assad, because Assad, up to this time, this was his most important, his most valuable strategic weapon, and we were going to essentially take it away from him.
Fairly unprecedented. I mean, in the middle of a conflict, you're asking a country to give up its perhaps most effective weapon.
This is important to remember. No country had ever done anything like this before. No, the community of countries had ever asked a country to do this. It's one thing to eliminate a weapon of mass destruction. It's happened a few times. South Africa used to have a nuclear weapon. It destroyed its stockpile. After the Cold War, the United States and Russia eliminated huge stockpiles of weapons. But it was all done over decades of time at great cost and not during a conflict. This was going to be compressed to a 9-month period. It would require a very invasive effort by outside inspectors and experts to come into the country to make sure it's being done right. And it was happening with kind of the bullets flying. The country was at war. There are scenes in the book where trucks are driving down highways and bullets and artillery shells are literally flying over the tops of them. So this was an extremely complicated, difficult thing to pull off. There's never been anything like it in history.
And you mentioned that it happened relatively quickly with the benefit of hindsight. Was the Obama administration too quick to take the Russian deal?
Mm-hmm. That is an interesting debate. There was a deal that was offered, and for Obama at the time, it was kind of a way out because it had reached the point where it really couldn't strike militarily as it promised to do, because Obama had made a big show of saying, well, I'm going to do this, but I'm going to get Congress behind me, and Congress didn't support him. Almost to a person, there were just a handful of Congress members and senators that were willing to support a military strike. So this was a way out, to have a face-saving way to show some resolve, to get something done that was also a national security objective, eliminate this weapon system. And so he reached a decision fairly quickly to make this happen. But what was really fast was the schedule for getting this stuff out, because we didn't even have a good inventory in the beginning of what Syria had. And to think that you could round up all those weapons from dozens of sites and take them out of the country and destroy them within 9 months seemed, as one person said in my book, on the border between feasible and insanity. And maybe it was closer to insanity.
So now I want to, you described the scene with bullets flying over the tops of vehicles. And that's a little preview into the storytelling technique that you use, which is really fantastic. Multiple reviews have talked about how it reads like a thriller. Now you really do create these three-dimensional characters. I want to ask you about how you select your cast of characters. There are three pages in the book of characters whose story you follow. It looks like the casting call for Red Line the movie.
it does. It seems the story is cinematic, and I think in the best way from a storyteller's point of view. It is horrible and tragic as the situation is. The characters are quite moving, including a lot of the Syrian ones. And so my intent, and I this has really been my style as a writer throughout my career, was not to focus on the big players, the pieces and individuals that we all know about, but get a layer or two down to the people that are making decisions in real time in the field, that are having to make life and death decisions in some places, to Syrians who are facing life and death circumstances, and to tell their stories and to use their experiences to sort of illustrate the larger points and the larger drama that was going on. And so you do have inspectors on the ground, guys coming from Europe and Canada and other places to oversee this incredibly complicated demilitarization program, taking weapons out. And you have Syrians who are, very much affected by this and trying to protect themselves and their families. And then you have American engineers and scientists who are trying to struggle with this really difficult question of, if we get these weapons out, what in the world are we going to do with them? Mm-hmm. And there is a whole part of the book is devoted to that problem.
Joby, how much of that approach has practical implications in that some of these non-headliners are more willing to speak to you and to subject themselves to interviews, where the headliners, heads of state and others, are less likely to do so?
It is absolutely true that you can get a little closer to ground truth by speaking to these folks a bit lower down, if they're willing to talk. And that takes, as a journalist, it takes some coaxing and some agreements in terms of, keeping certain things confidential and being transparent in your efforts. But I think almost to a person really, there was a interest in telling this story and having it told right, because all these people were involved in a drama that was, for many of them, was probably the most exciting and most interesting thing that'll happen in their lives. And they saw it happen, and they saw this, you know, the good parts and the bad parts take place in the flash of an eye, with much of the world not really paying attention. And so there was a real interest in a storytelling effort that would really bring these experiences to life. And that's what I tried to do in telling stories in this book.
Well, mission accomplished. There's no doubt that you not just tried, you succeeded. You know, I remember years ago, I interviewed Roger Wilkins after he wrote a book about Virginia's founding fathers. And he talked about how over the course of researching the book, that some people who he came in with really high estimation of, in one case, Thomas Jefferson, began to decline in his ratings or drop in his ratings. And then another person who he viewed almost superficially, George Washington, ended up being the hero of the story in his estimation. I'm wondering if you had any similar experiences to recount. Were there people who, once you dug into the story, your estimation of them began to decline? And were there others who emerged as heroes?
I think the surprising part to me related to that was how complicated the world was surrounding some of these characters that I thought I knew about coming in. And, and you know, Obama being one of them. I mean, I had certain opinions or beliefs that I think things I thought I knew coming in about Obama's decision making. And when you get in, you know, kind of peel the onion back and you kind of reconstruct what the decisions were like in real time in the White House, you come away with some humility that all these things, as much as they're criticized or as much as we can years later, you know, find fault or throw rocks, you know, in real time, these are excruciating choices that have to be made. Choices of life and death, choices of historical consequence, choices that could lead to other things. If we do get involved militarily, what's next? Is there a greater military involvement that could put potentially tens of thousands of Americans at risk? If we don't do something, is there a possibility that chemical weapons will slip out of this country and be used in New York or London or some other place? So all these things are, you know, they literally keep the characters awake at night. And that probably was the part of it that was just was eye-opening to me and really made me respect, in a way, the folks, some of them whom we never hear about, but had to help make these decisions in real time.
Have you heard from any of the protagonists since the publication of the book?
Yes, I have, from a number of them. And I must say that it pleases me that I haven't had any pushback in terms of accuracy, and that's been comforting. I try, part of my technique as well is maybe a little too much sharing, but I want to make sure that no one is surprised. And I've heard some very nice things from people who are at the center of the book, and others have been more reserved, but I don't, I hope that means that I didn't get something wrong, at least.
Looking ahead to sort of the denouement of the book, the outcomes, the bottom lines, is this a story of a lack of accountability for Assad that essentially changes the global calculation about whether or not chemical weapons can be used?
Yeah, that's a really good question, John, because it does get to a core issue that the book raises. There is a success on the chemical weapons front in the sense that the world does decide to confront this violation of this chemical weapons taboo. As well, you know, viewers will remember, chemical weapons was one of the only weapons systems that the entire world decided we can't use these. They were used in a horrific way in World War I. They've been used a few times since then, but we have a, you know, international treaty that says you can't use them. And so going in and forcing Assad to give up at least most of his stockpile in 2013 and 14 was, in a way, an enforcement of this red line, of this taboo. On the other hand, Assad is never really forced to be accountable. He never has to admit to using any of these weapons. He continues to insist he didn't, that it was others, it was false flag operations, it was the rebels, whatever. So he's never been held to account. He's certainly never been brought before any kind of court of justice, or even, you know, forced to face any real consequence. And so that is an erosion of the taboo. And you can see the consequences of it, because in the years since these events, you see Russia, for example, using chemical weapons to carry out attempted assassinations outside its borders, and North Korea doing the same, trying to kill a relative of Kim Jong-un at an airport in Malaysia. So there is this weakening that has gone on, and that I think it's why the idea of accountability is still so vital. You know, it's been a decade since the war began, but there has to be some effort to bring justice. And I do think that effort is still underway.
Speaking of Russia, a second red line emerges in the story. Russia's red line, that they want to keep Assad in power, and he's still in power. When in the story does it become clear that Russia is committed to Assad as their own red line?
This becomes a real discovery for me as well, as I'm on this journey of writing this book, because there's a sense that if the United States had intervened more dramatically, more aggressively early on in the campaign, then things might have gone differently. What people have to remember looking back, and is so clear now, is that Russia and Iran both were absolutely committed to keeping Assad in power. They were willing to do whatever they could, whatever it took, including huge amounts of their own treasury, all kinds of weapons, and ultimately their own troops, airplanes, troops on the ground, in the case of Iran, particularly, thousands of Iranian troops and advisors brought into this battle, and many of them lost their lives. So the way I end up describing it is Russia and Iran were more committed to keeping Assad in power than the United States and the West was committed to making him go. And they were willing to put much more on the line to make sure that they succeeded, because for them, Assad is truly an issue of their own national security interests. For us, it's a little bit more, abstract. It's the goal of stability. We want, aspirations of, democratic seeking masses in Syria. But for Syria and for Russia and for Iran, it was a true national security interest to keep this man in power. And that's why they put so much effort into it.
The story continues. Is there an end in sight? What seemed at many times during the past decade to be something that was about to reach an acute stage and end in some way has just become a chronic circumstance.
It is frustrating to say the least, and tragic for people in Syria, that this conflict is now in its 10th year. And while Assad has won to the extent that he's clearly holding on to power, he controls Damascus and the major cities, the war has not ended, and there is in fact this enclave in the north and some areas to the northeast that are controlled by his opponents. Those lines don't seem to be moving very much. There's every expectation that unless there's some intervention in some unforeseen way, this conflict continues, and it brings all the terrible things that wars do: instability, refugees, humanitarian crises. So that continues. There is hope, because as you mentioned, there is this ebb and flow to events. And I think we're at a point now where Syria is again in a crisis, where their economy is in free fall. You see demonstrations popping up in places like Damascus, where people can't get enough to eat. And so those kinds of pressures could present an opportunity. Maybe there's a chance now that Russia and the new administration in Washington can sit down and try to figure something out. I can't begin to imagine what that will be. But there is an inflection point, I think, and it should be, we should pay attention to it and try to do something with it.
We've mentioned it in passing, but I want to ask you, I'd be remiss to not focus in a bit on the Islamic State and how it factors into this whole story, not just the story you've told, but the ongoing story. And if you're looking, I suppose, for some success within the story of Red Line, it's the fact that the Islamic State did not acquire these weapons.
That's true, because this was something that ISIS wanted. And we know this because of its own pronouncements. It is said publicly that it wants weapons of mass destruction. Al-Qaeda certainly said that. And we know from its history, it has used chemical weapons in the past. And so if an opportunity presented itself for ISIS to seize weapons, it surely would have done it, and it surely would have used them. But since it didn't have that chance, since most of the weapons were taken out of the country in 2014, it did the next best thing, which is to try to make its own stockpile. And so you see this really frightening prospect of a terrorist group, which in 2014 had territory. We recall it held the city of Mosul, the second largest city in Iraq, with universities and laboratories, and it launched a dedicated program to make chemical weapons. It didn't get very far. It made some, it used some, but the United States and its allies were so alarmed by this possibility that we devoted a lot of resources to try to smash this program before it got along very far. And it appears that we succeeded. We know from ISIS's rhetoric that it hasn't given up on the idea, but a truly potentially disastrous situation was taken off the battlefield because we worked really hard to make this this kind of new capability go away.
Well, it's a terrific achievement. And I think back, I mentioned that you'd done a Wilson Center book event. And for people interested in that discussion with Jane Harmon and Jim Jeffrey and Rob Litvak, they can check the page on this website where they can view this program, and you'll find a link to that as well. But something that I noticed in that discussion, which I'm sure you must have found very gratifying, is Jim Jeffrey, a guy who was up to his neck in this as an ambassador within the administration, talked about how much more he learned about Syria, and he thought he knew a lot about it.
That was a bit of a shock to me as well, because I was going to these things assuming that, you know, I do my best as a journalist, but we can only scratch the surface so far. But I do think that there's value, and maybe this is why books like this are useful, in bringing all these diverse elements of a very complicated story together and doing it as a story, you know, in a way that kind of makes sense, because we learn from stories. And I do feel there was some value in that.
And you can't do that kind of journalism in real time.
It's really, really hard. We try sometimes, but to put together a profile in a single day, especially in the 24-hour news cycle, is really tough. So the nice thing about being able to stay at Ed Wilson, which I had the opportunity to do for 6 months, is you have peace and quiet and the ability to think long form and to try to bring together the very different elements of this book and make them work as a single piece.
Is that the key difference for a journalist like you, a workaday journalist who then suddenly is at a fellowship in the Wilson Center where you can close the door, you're not on deadline within the next 24 hours, and you can step back, not just take the time to do deeper research, but also just step back perhaps and gain a little more perspective when you're not caught up in the daily rat race?
I can't tell you what a difference that pace made for me just being at a place like Wilson, where you do have a door that closes, but you're also surrounded by, you know, really big thinkers and colleagues that you can call on, have lunch with and coffee with, and just bounce ideas. In the 24/7 news cycle that is most newsrooms these days, it is like being on a treadmill. It's finishing the story today and then worrying about what tomorrow's event is going to be. And so having the space to kind of step back and think, well, what's really important here, and really get your attention off the next tweet or off the next, you know, reiteration of a lead on a story, and think about what's really important and what historically is important. And that's a wonderful opportunity. And I just greatly value the chance to do that at Wilson.
Well, we were happy to host you and hope to do so again, although I won't put any pressure on you asking you about your next book. Wait, that's a final thought I have. What's it like when you hit the finish line on a project like this, which takes so much time and effort? Is it just relief, the exhaustion, or are you energized in a way where you are starting to think about the next project?
In my case, and maybe this is just my own neuroses, but there's a moment of terror, actually. So you finish it and you're relieved that you made your deadlines, and then you second guess everything that you've done, because a book is a million decisions. You know, did I put too much emphasis on this or not on that? Or did this source maybe mislead me? And I'm wondering if I should have tried to get a third or a fourth source to confirm something. And so for me, it's just beating myself up every day and hoping that I didn't screw up something terribly. And it's the real gratifying part. There's never really a moment where you relax, but when it comes out and people say, well, I enjoyed this, and then you feel like, okay, well, that's a reward. And that's something you don't get in daily journalism very much either, I must say.
Well, your track record speaks for itself, but I still would not discourage you from that humility that leads you to second guess, because that keeps you honest, right?
Absolutely. And you can't, the minute that you become too cocky about what you've done, that's the moment that you realize that you've bungled in some unforeseen way. And because it's a very public thing, it's a public embarrassment. So that's what keeps you up at night sometimes.
Well, here's something to be proud of in public, not an embarrassment. Red Line, it's terrific. Joby, thanks for joining us today. Congratulations on the book, and look forward to the next time we have an opportunity to speak.
Really enjoyed this, John. Thank you for having me.
A pleasure. And we hope that you enjoyed this as well, and that you'll join us again soon for another edition of Wilson Center Now. Until then, for all of us at the Center, I'm John Molesky. Thanks for being here.